Just to maybe clarify what these two entities are, the IIT Madras is one of the IITs in the country. It's probably well known. I'm not going to dwell on it. It's just across the road. This particular entity is the country's first university-based research park. It's the IIT Madras Research Park. It's physically a separate entity, though it's conveniently right next door to the campus, and it's also legally a separate entity. This facility houses broadly three types of entities. There are many companies here whose research divisions are located here, and they are here only because they collaborate with IIT Madras in their work. No company that has this research division here continues here if there's no reason for them to be here by way of collaboration. The second type of entity, which is very large, very important part of this facility, are the startups, all the startups incubated by our incubation cell of IIT Madras are all located here, and there have been more than 100 of them currently present here. Of course, there are several which have incubated and graduated, and some have shut down. The third is there are a few centers of the institute. These are centers that are very often multidisciplinary, and also the reason they are here and not in the laboratories of the institute is because their work is very heavily translational, and they have to focus completely on delivery within timelines, work with users, agencies, companies, work with government, whoever it is. The scope of activity is very, very, very large for a typical academic laboratory. So we sort of separate them out here. The International Center for Clean Water, which is going to be inaugurated very soon, is also one such center. It's one of seven such centers that are located here. And that will tell you the sort of the focus that IIT Madras faculty from multiple departments have in the area of water. And we sort of over the years, it's faculty who work in and students who work in water are spread across many, many departments, and increasingly I'm seeing almost every department of the institute is involved or going to be involved. It's not just the environmental and water resources engineering division of the civil engineering department or the chemistry department or biotechnology, but you know, a lot of the issues of water relates to the engineering aspects, the transportation systems, the treatment systems. If you are setting up any kind of sewage treatment, it's basically a whole lot of chemical engineering, transport, you know, if your pipelines, motors, machines, all these are energy consumed in all of this. So that there's not a department that's not involved. And increasingly, faculty from many departments, if not all yet, are involved in this and through this interdisciplinary research center that I just mentioned. And we have learned that it's complex. Urban water is complex in itself. Then you have rural water. Then you have agriculture. These are very complicated. And then you have hydrology. You have river, you know, issues of our rivers. But if this meeting, as I can see, is focused on rural water, but that in itself and rural water for not so much for agriculture, I presume, but could be, I don't know, I've not looked at the full program, but just rural water for direct human consumption itself is a complex problem. But we've learned here to sort of divide it up into two or three parts, focus on, you know, there's a 5 liters or so per head that you have to deliver every day for ingestion. For consumption, which has to have certain health, you know, from a health standpoint, which has to meet certain criteria. Then you need water for personal use, bathing and so on, cooking, washing clothes. And then you need water for flushing. So all of these have, and then there is the whole issue of treatment of grey water. So we're also learning that it might be a good idea to not mix everything up and have several grades of grey water and treat them differently. We are also learning that one ideally should come out with what I would call appliances, water appliances. You know, in the consumer world of today, an appliance is something that you connect it up yourself, like your TV set, or at the worst case, you have to get somebody in to fix it for you, like your water heater or your air conditioner. But after that, pretty much, you can use it without worrying about it. you know, sort of fix it and forget kind of procurement. Maybe it requires some maintenance once in a while, but not a, it doesn't require constant babysitting. So we need appliances for many, for the treatment of grey water. The kind of appliances that you get in many other domains, I believe, are not that readily available in the area of water treatment. They are much harder to look after. They require careful nurturing, and this has to change. So again, there's a lot of engineering, there's a lot of design that's involved in getting it to that point. A lot of new technologies are involved, sensors, automatic repair systems and so on. Many things which are actually, as a concept, very common in other disciplines. I come from the world of telecommunications. Telecommunication networks have many of these features. They have many self-healing features. They have extremely high, reporting of impending problems or existing problems. They have ways of keeping the network alive, even if some part of it goes bad. All kinds of things are there in those networks. It's a very different domain, but conceptually, some of those things have to come in this area of what I call water appliances. And that's one direction in which we are moving in this institute. How do you deal with grey water, sometimes very locally, almost at the level of the point of consumption, and sometimes at the level of the household unit or at the level of the, if it's the urban area, at the level of the building? We're very interested, for example, how do you deal with the issue of water for the crores and crores of toilets that we are building in the country? How do you make it, how do you develop a sort of leaking closed loop system there? Leaking because, engineers never, we just don't like systems that are infinite closed loops. So we need something to leak out. So, and then how do you, supply the difference? So all keep updating the amount of water in the system. So all these kinds of issues are what we are grappling with. And it's very interesting in one way. It's also very important. And even as we grapple with this very year, we are in the city of Chennai, we are faced with a water crisis of our making. So our institute also therefore affected. Just yesterday we had a meeting to decide what to do, try to extend the summer vacation and so on. Very, very, unfortunate kind of actions that we have to take to deal with the problem, which is completely of our own making. So this is, there's no good time to have meetings or to discuss how to deal with water and what to do about it. It's always a good time. So it's as good a time as any. I want to therefore end my brief comments here by commending, I welcome you to this meeting again. I hope we come out with really interesting ideas and good solutions. Not easy, as I said, not easy to come out with systems that work reliably without too much attention, and almost any problem involving water looks like it has very simple solutions, but when you come to start implementing them, you realize what are the issues. There are many, many issues that come in the way of making it something that will work 365 days, 24 hours, and year after year. So wishing you all the best and looking forward to some really good solutions emerging from the meeting of so many minds. Thank you.